Hi friends, welcome to our YouTube channel Knowledge Academy. The main aim of this lecture is to discuss about the TSPSC General Studies in a very detailed manner. If you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button. So whenever we upload a new video, the direct notification comes to mobile. If any improvements lectures, then please do comment in the comment section. We will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. So why do waste more time? So let's get started. Now we are going to solve the 36th question. See the question here. Approximately how much percentage of India is flood prone? See, approximately how much land of the India is prone for flood? So option A 8%, option B 12%, option C 25%, option D 35%. So out of the four options, option B 12% is the correct solution. So let's discuss something more about this one. So now we will discuss which are the states which are majorly the flood prone states. So the major flood prone states in India, so therefore the states are Punjab, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, North Bihar, West Bengal, Coastal Andhra Pradesh, Orissa, Southern Gujarat and Kerala, Tamil Nadu, Assam. So these are the states which are going to happen the flood prone in every state in every year. These are the major states which are going to have the flood prone effects in India. So out of these states, the most severe flood prone are occurs in the states of the North Bihar, West Bengal and Assam. These three states, every year the majority of flood prone are going to occur in these states out of these total states. So majorly North Bihar, West Bengal and Assam, these states are going to have a severe amount of flood prone when compared to the remaining states. So here in the question they ask how much percentage of area of the Indian land is prone for the flood. So here 12%. So 12% of area in India is flood prone. So therefore the correct solution is 12%. And if they ask which are the major states which are going to have the severe amount of flood prone, is nothing but north side of the Bihar and the West Bengal and Assam. These three states are going to have a severe amount of flood prone every year. So among this remaining states, the remaining states also have the same amount of the flood prone, but it is very less when compared to these three states. So therefore 12% of area in India is a flood prone majority. Now we are going to solve the 37th question. See the question here. Which type of disaster is the Bhopal tragedy? So what is the type of disaster of the Bhopal tragedy? We need to figure out. So option A biological, option B chemical, option C natural, option D difficult to categorize. So out of the four options, option B chemical. So the type of disaster of the Bhopal tragedy is nothing but a chemical. So let's discuss something more about this one. So now we'll discuss something more about the Bhopal gas tragedy. So here on the 2nd December 1984, a gas named which is methyl isocyanate. So the gas name is methyl isocyanate gas. It was leaked from the company. The company name is United Carbide India Limited. So this company is nothing but a pesticide plant. So they say this company is going to prepare the or make the pesticides for the plants. So this company is called as a pesticide plant. So the company name is United Carbide India Limited. So from this company the gas leakage has happened. The gas name is methyl isocyanate. So in the question they will ask how much amount of gas which is leakage means 40 tons of. So total the gas leakage is 40 tons of methyl isocyanate gas was leakage from this company. The company name is United Carbide India Limited. This company is nothing but a pesticide plant. So and they will ask on which day this event has happened, means on the 2nd December 1984. So on this day the gas name methyl isocyanate of 40 tons of methyl isocyanate was leakaged from the company. The company name is United Carbide India Limited. This company is nothing but a pesticide plant. So because of this leakage of the gas, the people around that plant are severely died and also they are severely injured. So nearly 3,787 people died because of this leakage of the gas, and nearly 574,366 injured people are very injured very badly because of this disaster. So nearly 3,787 people got died and nearly 574,366 people are injured very badly because of this leakage of the methyl isocyanate. So it is nothing but a chemical. This is nothing but a chemical. So that is why we are going to say it as a chemical disaster. So because of this chemical leakage, we say it as a chemical disaster. and the location. See, the plant is located in the Bhopal. The plant is located in the Bhopal, which is present in the Madhya Pradesh. So this tragedy is also called as the Bhopal gas tragedy because it is present in the Bhopal. So therefore, still today that site is very, very toxic. Still today, even now, that site is a very toxic place. So you cannot go without any precautions. You have to go to the place with always a certain type of precautions. So Bhopal is a very famous, it's also called as a city of lakes because the lakes are natural and artificial made lakes. So Bhopal is also called as a city of lakes. So in this, out of this important facts, the very, very important fact is the most asked examination, methyl isocyanate. They will ask which type of gas is nothing but methyl isocyanate. 40 tons of methyl isocyanate was leakaged from this company. The company name is United Carbide India Limited. It is nothing but a pesticide plant, and it was happened in the 2nd December 1984. Because of this leakage, 3,787 people got died and nearly 5,74,366 people got injured very badly. Because there is a chemical, that's why it is called as a chemical disaster. And the location of this plant is nothing but Bhopal, which is present in the Madhya Pradesh. So here, still today, even that site is very, very toxic. So Bhopal is also called as a city of lakes, means it is natural lakes and artificial lakes present in the Bhopal. That's why it is called as a city of lakes. These are the very, very important facts. So now we'll discuss the 38th question. See the question here. Where is Nandankanan Zoological Park located? So where is Nandankanan Zoological Park located? Option A, Odisha. Option B, West Bengal. Option C, Assam. Option D, Jharkhand. So out of the four options, option A, Odisha. So Nandankanan Zoological Park is located in Odisha. So let's discuss something more facts about this one. So now we'll discuss something important facts of the Nandankanan Zoological Park. This park is the second largest zoo in India. This is nothing but a second largest zoo in India. And similarly, the location of this park is nothing but it is present in Bhubaneswar. It is present in Bhubaneswar. So Bhubaneswar is present in the Odisha. So that's why our answer is Odisha, because in the options they are given the states. So it is present in the city, Bhubaneswar city, but it is present in the state of Odisha. And similarly, the total animals which are present in this zoo is nothing but nearly 3,517 as per the latest year. So the total variety of species, different type of species, total how many species are which are present in this zoo is nothing but 157 as per the latest data. And similarly, it is founded. This park was founded in the year 29th December 1960. So on this day, this park was founded. And similarly, these are the important things of the Nandankanan Zoological Park. This park is the second largest zoo in India. So that is why I have written, it is the second largest zoo in India. This park is the second largest zoo in India. But what is the first? So the first largest zoo in India, it is present in Chennai. The zoo name is nothing but the largest zoo in India is called as the Arignar. It is also called as the Anna Zoological Park or Wanderer Zoo. So if they ask what is the second largest zoo, it is called as the Nandankanan Zoological Park. And if they ask what is the first largest zoo in India, then we can say Arignar, Anna Zoological Park or Wanderer Zoo. So these are the three different names of this park. So if they ask in the question, which is the smallest zoo in India? The smallest zoo in India is nothing but Maharaj Bagh Zoo. So Maharaj Bagh Zoo is the smallest zoo in India and it is present in the Maharashtra. So the first zoological largest park is present in Chennai, and the second largest zoo is present in the Odisha, and the third and the very, very smallest, means last smallest zoo is India is present in the Maharashtra. These are the three important names, and you need to remember this is almost it's asked in every competitive examinations. So these are the important facts of this Nandankanan Zoological Park. So now we are going to solve the 39th question. See the question here. GST Act was passed in the Parliament in. So GST Act was passed in the Parliament in which year? Option A 2013, option B 2015, option C 2014, option D 2016. So out of the four options, option D 2016. So GST Act was passed in the Parliament in the year 2016. So let's discuss something more about this one. Now we'll discuss the important facts of the GST. GST Act Bill. GST is nothing but a goods and service tax. This is nothing but a whole country has one single tax. So GST is nothing but whole country has only one single tax, and the previously for each and every state the tax is different, but here after the implementation of GST the whole country is going to have the same tax. So that is the purpose of the GST. Goods and service tax is nothing but whole country has only single type of tax. And this bill was passed in Rajya Sabha. So this bill was passed in the Rajya Sabha on the date 3rd August 2016. So therefore here on this date the bill was passed in the Rajya Sabha, and similarly it was passed in the Lok Sabha. This bill was passed in the Lok Sabha 8th August 2016. So therefore we can conclude that this bill was passed in the parliament in the year 2016. Is the reason parliament is nothing but Rajya Sabha and the Lok Sabha. So therefore on the year 2016 this bill was passed in the parliament on the year 2016. So if they ask specifically on which date the bill was passed in Rajya Sabha, we need to figure out, we need to write 3rd August 2016. And if they ask on which date the bill was passed in the Lok Sabha, then we have to say 8th August 2016. So the first it was passed in Rajya Sabha and then it went to the Lok Sabha for passing. So therefore then it is passed in there in the Lok Sabha in this state. So first it was went to Rajya Sabha and then it is went to Lok Sabha. So therefore this is the date you need to remember. So now it went to the, then after passing from the Lok Sabha, this went to the President Pranab Mukherjee. At that time, the President was Pranab Mukherjee. So therefore, now he was passed away. At that time, the President was Pranab Mukherjee. So he approved the bill on the date 8th September 2016. So on this date, the President Pranab Mukherjee has signed this bill. So therefore, this implemented from the 1st July 2017. It was signed on this date by the President Pranab Mukherjee, but it was implemented or effect. It was effect from the this date, 1st July 2017. From this day onwards only, this act was implemented in the India from the date 1 July 2017. So this is a very, very important question. In the question they will ask on which date the GST was implemented in the India, means 1st July 2017 onwards. GST is nothing but it is an indirect tax, or it is also called as a consumption tax on the goods and service tax. So therefore it is called as an indirect tax or the consumption tax on goods and service tax. So therefore this is the things which are very, very important. And now we will learn some of the important facts of the GST. So GST was first implemented in the country France. So GST was first implemented in the country France. And similarly, India's GST is based on the Canadian model. In the question they will ask, on which model the GST was based in India? So in India's GST is based on the Canadian model, and it was recommended. So GST in India, it was recommended by the Vijay Kelkar committee. So on this committee recommendations only GST was implemented in India. So because of this committee recommendations, so GST came in. So this GST was implemented on the Article 279 of the Indian Constitution of 101 Amendment Act. So from this act only, in the Article 279, this act was passed. So therefore, India's GST is based on the Canadian model, and it was recommended by the Vijay Kelkar committee, and this was implemented from the Article 279 from the 101 Amendment Act. So therefore, these are the important facts here. If you are not paying this GST, means you are going to get a 5 years jail. So if you are not paying this GST to the government of India, then you need to have a 5 years of jail. So therefore now Assam is the first state in India implemented the GST. So in India, Assam is the first state in India which has implemented the GST very successfully. And in the question they will ask, who is the brand ambassador of GST in India? Is nothing but Amitabh Bachchan. So Amitabh Bachchan is the brand ambassador of GST in India. So this is a very important fact here. So if you're not paying any of the GST to the government of India, then you have to go for a 5 years of jail. Indian GST, there are 5 rates of tax are present in the GST. So in the question, how many rates of tax are present in GST, means it is 5, which are 0%, 5%, 12%, 18% and 28%. These are the 5 different rates of percentages are present in the GST. So this is a very, very important point. 5 rates of tax are present in the GST. So here, after the GST, this was eliminated. Tax upon tax was eliminated because of GST. In the previously, the tax is upon tax upon tax, tax upon the tax. So it was eliminated because of the GST. So because of GST only, tax upon tax was eliminated. So these are the important facts here. And after the implementation of GST, these things also eliminated, which are sales tax, service tax, custom duty tax, excess duty tax, VAT tax, or trade tax. So these are nothing but tax upon tax. All these are eliminated. All these are eliminated with the help of GST. So after the implementation of GST, all these tax upon tax, these are different tax, which are sales tax, service tax, custom duty tax, excess duty, VAT, or trade tax, all these are eliminated because of the GST. So this is the very, very important facts of the GST. So let me repeat again here. GST is nothing but a whole country as going to have the only single type of tax, and this was first went to the Rajya Sabha for passing, and it was passed in Rajya Sabha 3rd August 2016, and then it went to the Lok Sabha on the date 8th August 2016 it was passed. So because of Rajya Sabha, Lok Sabha is nothing but parliament, so therefore on the year 2016 the GST was passed in the parliament, and then it went to the Pranab Mukherjee, President Pranab Mukherjee at that time, and he was approved this bill on this date 8th September 2016, and it was implemented effectively in India from 1st July 2017. This is a very, very important point here. And this is nothing but a indirect tax or consumption tax on the goods and service. So this is nothing but a indirect tax or the consumption tax on goods and service. So it was first implemented in the country of France. And India's GST is based on the Canadian model. It was recommended by the Vijay Kelkar Committee. So from the Article 2279 and the 101 Amendment Act, this was came in India. And Assam is the first state. So Assam is the first state in India which has successfully implemented the GST. And if they ask who is the brand ambassador of GST, is none other than Amitabh Bachchan. So if you are not paying the GST to the government of India, then you need to go for a jail of 5 years. And five different rates are presented in the GST tax. It's nothing but 0%, 5%, 12%, 18%, and 28%. So because of GST, only tax upon tax was eliminated. So the tax upon tax is nothing but sales tax, service tax, custom duty tax, excess duty tax, VAT tax, or trade tax. All these taxes are eliminated because of the GST. So these are the good effects of the GST. So now we'll discuss the 40th question. What is RuPay? Option A, Indian version of payment card. Option B, online portal for payments. Option C, electronic money. Option D, Indian Bitcoin. So out of the four options, RuPay is nothing but option A, Indian version of payment card. So let's discuss something more about this one. So now we'll discuss what is the RuPay card. So RuPay card is nothing but it is an Indian payment system. It was created by the National Payments Corporation of India. It's nothing but India's payment system. Because it was developed by the Indian, that's why it's called as the India's payment system. It was created by the National Payment Corporation of India. So simply we say it as a Indian version of payment card. So it was developed by the India, that's why it's called as a Indian version of the payment card. So it is international card payment service, means it is used by some of the countries also, this accept this card. So some of the countries also accept this card in order to pay the money. So therefore, in the some of the few countries, with the help of this Indian RuPay card, we can pay the money. If this card was accepted by only few countries, but not all the countries, so if you go to that limited country and if you want to pay the money through this card, then they will accept the money, but not in the other countries. So it was launched in the year 26th March 2012 by the government of India. See, I will tell the why, the reason India has developed this one, I will tell you later here. See, the previously what happens is, previously when there is no ATMs, then every person has to go to the bank in order to collect the money. So therefore it is a very severe pain, because each one has to stand in a queue, and for lot of hours they have to wait in order to take the money. So this is a very severe pain. So then what they did is, the banks did these small things. So they have changed, they have made the ATMs. So therefore, people now no need to go to the bank in order to take the money. So they can directly go to the ATMs and they can take the money. So now the work is very simple. But now in order to take this money, so ATMs, this bank will offer three types of cards. So in order to take the services, so the bank will offer three types of cards, which is nothing but RuPay card, Visa card, MasterCard. So this Visa card and the MasterCard are created by the foreign companies, so not by the India. So these foreign companies created this card. So by this card, these foreign companies have to get more commissions. Therefore, the bank has to pay more commission for these foreign companies. But here rupee. So because of this high commissions only, the India developed this rupee card. So it is an Indian company. So rupee card was created by the Indian company with a less commission. So now banks can pay less commission. This rupee takes very less commission from the people, but the foreign companies take more amount of commission from the Indian people. That is the reason this rupee card was created by the government of India. So here this was used in only limited countries. Only limited countries accept this payment, but this Visa card and MasterCard used all over the world. So with the help of these two cards, you can pay wherever you go. You can use this payment card in order to pay the money, but not by the rupee. Rupee is used only for the limited amount of countries. So here, if any bank can join this payment service for free, so without paying any money, any bank can join this rupee card scheme. But here the banks, in order to join these two companies, they have to pay the money. So this is a very severe pain. That is the reason it is made free of cost, but it is a, you need to pay the money. So but if you take these two cards, then you can go anywhere in the world and you can buy this card, you can pay the money, but not by this rupee card. Rupee card is used for only the limited countries. So especially in India, you can use this one rupee card anywhere, but not in the other countries. So this is the important facts of the rupee card. Successfully completed the 40 questions, which are the previous year questions of the TSPSC General Studies. If you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button. So whenever you upload a new video, the direct notification comes to mobile. If any improvements see in video lectures, then please do comment in the comment section. You will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. Thank you so much for watching this lecture. Keep smiling, take care, and bye.